about the experience of wow. And I thought about a couple of experiences that I've had, and I just want to start with those experiences. And it's a little bit of a travelogue, but don't worry, the sermon isn't all travel. We get our friends. So, when I was about ready to take my first sabbatical, I received this great piece of advice from a minister colleague. Travel, he told me, and I mean really travel. Leave the hemisphere and don't come back until the sabbatical is over. And listening to that advice was probably some of the best advice that I've ever received. So that's what I did. A couple of parishioners, the Sunday before I was due to leave, handed me checks for $1,000. I think they wanted me gone longer or something like that. But the two places that I really badly wanted to go, and the two places that I set out to go on my sabbatical were to go to the Galapagos Islands and the Amazon rainforest. Both of these places are chocked full of wow. The thing about the Galapagos Islands is that they are an ecosystem that is completely devoid of land-based predators. So the animals that you encounter there are at worst completely indifferent to you, and at best kind of fascinated and playful with you. Our first encounter with the Galapagos land iguana occurred when our group was following a path, and we turned a corner in the path, and there on the path was this 4.5-foot orange lizard, orange iguana, and sunning itself in the middle of the path. And since we had to stay on the path, our only option was to one at a time step over it and continue on. And this lizard was totally indifferent to us. He actually just sort of kind of opened his eyes at one point and looked up like, "You're blocking my son, hurry up." Wild. You can approach and stare into the eye of an 800-pound Galapagos giant tortoise, and the animal will look back at you with curiosity. If you lie down on a sandy beach, sea lion pups will come over and try to use you as a pillow. It was an experience of wow. This experience of wow, and this sense that it all seems surreal and impossible, like nature just isn't supposed to do that. Wow. The Amazon rainforest also gave me an experience of wow, but almost a different category of wow. Our first night in the jungle, our guide led us on a nighttime walk into the jungle. He conducted this walk in total darkness, but he brought along a flashlight that when he would flash on to show us a type of lizard or a type of spider. But I have to tell you, being in the middle of the jungle, in the rain, in total darkness, was a kind of a wow that was terrifying. Everything around you is alive and immense, and the sounds of the night are so loud that you almost have to put your hands over your ears because it's just so loud. And I experienced there that chill of primordial fear that I had never experienced before or since. It was wow. The good news is that you don't have to take a sabbatical or travel to another hemisphere to have that experience of wow. Since last January, I have been undertaking a reading project, reading every poem written by Mary Oliver at a rate of about 4 or 5 poems a day, and I've been doing that since January, and I'll end right around December. My thanks goes out to a member of this congregation who works very closely with the UNC Library and has actually found me all these volumes of Mary Oliver poems that are rare. And let me just say, Mary Oliver, she's been called the Poet Laureate of Unitarian Universalism because her poems are so frequently read as scripture in UU worship services. Ruth began our service this morning with this poem called Why I Wake Early. Mary Oliver is so attentive to nature that you get the feeling that she could spend a few minutes in your backyard and have a soul-shaking experience of awe and wonder and beauty and astonishment. Her poetry proves that you don't have to go to the Galapagos Islands, but that the white pine, the Carolina wren, the wild geese, the blue iris are capable of giving you a glimpse of wow if you only pay attention. If you're like me and like many Unitarian Universalists, when we think of that experience, those experiences of awe and wonder, those experiences of amazing, soul-stirring astonishment, we often first think to experiences of nature, right? But don't think for a second that those experiences of wow can only be or must only be found in nature. We can have our breath taken away and exclaim a gasping wow in response to a work of art. Painting, a sculpture, a Beethoven symphony, a song by our choir. We can be wowed by an athletic or physical accomplishment, a perfect gymnastic routine, the game-winning three-point shot at the buzzer, a Cirque du Soleil routine. We can be wowed by a scientific or technological breakthrough. Claim wow to the sequencing of the human genome or the International Space Station. And we can be wowed. We can be wowed by human courage, human compassion, human generosity, human determination. We respond. We respond in amazement and wonder and awe to the miracle of birth and often to the miracle of death. My friend, UU minister Jason Shelton, has a sermon in which he talks about awe and wonder being the core spiritual experience for Unitarian Universalists. Indeed, we acknowledge that awe in our first source, where we claim that our religious experience derives from, quote, direct experience of that transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces that create and uphold life. Direct experience of that transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures that moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces that create and uphold life. Spiritual writer Anne Lamott once wrote a short book about prayer with the title Help, Thanks, Wow. She says that our most deeply honest and deeply felt prayers are often the shortest and simplest. And wow, she says, that articulation of amazement, that sound we make as our breath is being taken away, is, for Anne Lamott, a kind of prayer. Some etymologists believe that the word wow is actually a contraction, a shortening of a two-word sentence. The two-word sentence, I vow. That wow is just a shorter way of saying I vow, as in a promise. Isn't that an interesting thought? That the experience of having your mind completely blown by something, that your reaction to that is to make, in that moment with your breath, to make a vow, to make a commitment, to make a promise. I'm reminded of a humorous example of this, that last January, after Clemson University in South Carolina won the national championship in football in spectacular fashion, a local church just down the road posted the following on their church sign. To those who made promises last night, services start at 11. there's astonishment resulting in a promise, I guess. But seriously, doesn't that make sense to think of wow as a contraction of I vow? Because that experience of being wowed, of being amazed, of having our breath taken away, often results in some commitment. Being wowed by nature often results in making some commitment to reverence for and protection of the natural world. We become inspired not to take beauty for granted, not to take life for granted. That wow of seeing a piece of art or a a piece of beautiful music is to make this inner promise that I'm gonna support the arts and make sure that these things, I'm gonna attend them, make sure these things continue to happen because I value it. We become inspired not to take beauty for granted, not to take life for granted. We become inspired to hold life reverently. Anne Lamott says that wow can be our reaction not only to things like the natural world that amazes us, but she says that wow can also be our reaction to shocking and horrible things that occur. She says, for example, that we can say wow in response to a terror attack. But it's on this point that I disagree with her. I think that a gasp is not the same thing as a wow. Contemporary philosopher Paul Woodruff, in his book entitled Reverence, writes that the experience of reverence involves holding several different emotions together in proper proportion and intensity. Woodruff says that reverence is made up primarily of awe and respect, with a couple shakes of a couple other emotions in. I'm not going to get into those. So according to Woodruff, reverence is holding awe and respect together in proper measure. According to Woodruff, reverence is a virtue, that wow is actually a moral response. Reverence is possessing a combination of both awe and respect in proper proportion and intensity. And that experience of awe, you can feel that awe towards wonderful things, but you can also feel awe towards awful things. You can be awed by cruelty and callousness. Gasp. You can be awed by intentionally destructive acts. Gasp. Remember back to the start of the Iraq War in 2003 and that campaign of aerial bombing that was planned was going to be called, what was it? Shock and awe. You can experience awe in response to horrifyingly immoral things, but reverence is not the same as awe. Reverence is made up of awe and respect blended together. It's not just respect. There's all sorts of things that you can respect that don't fill you with awe. You can respect copyright laws. You can respect the speed limit. You can respect people in positions of authority, but that's not the same as reverence. But reverence is only possible when respect and awe are wedded together. So I'm there in the Amazon rainforest, and we're out in this kind of waterway in a canoe, and the guide points, and there coming around the bend in the waterway are two pink river dolphins. Who even knew that there was such a thing as pink river dolphins? They are a species of freshwater dolphin that live in the Amazon. And in fact, their skin is not gray or kind of bluish gray like the dolphins in the ocean, but kind of this grayish pink. And they swim and they're kind of, you know, doing the, these are, they're not quite as beautiful as ocean dolphins, so don't think too much wow. But this was, sorry, pink river dolphins, but this was, wow, I had no idea that this was even a thing. And there it is in front of me. And that is awe, but I think that reverence is not only that experience of awe, but that response. That what it elicits from within us, what it elicits from our souls and our commitments. That what commitment do we make to living on this planet in a way that harms it less, in a way that preserves this kind of natural wonder and beauty, that reverence is the proper blending of awe and respect. Reverence has a deeply moral dimension. truth as a minister, there are some weeks when you just sort of struggle with what to say, right? You know, it seems like every week I could come in here and say, wow, what a week, right? And it'd be true, it's something different, wow, what a week. And so I've been thinking about this. I've been thinking about this and kind of weighing that reality with the other reality of starting every morning with a handful of poems by Mary Baldwin that elicit this experience of reverence. And what I've come to discover is that reverence has a moral component to its very core, and that reverence is actually a form of resistance, that reverence is a form of declaring that I'm going to be in this world a certain way, in a way that upholds beauty, in a way that upholds glory, in a way that notices not only the pain, but notices those moments of awe. Reverence is a moral act. I wonder about reverence, though. I wonder about it. I was thinking back this past week to a story from something that happened during my very, very, very first year of doing ministry in a church. Somebody not at all affiliated with the church had called the church asking for somebody to be willing to do a short memorial service. And of course, when that happens, it gets farmed out to the intern, which I was at the time. And so I was dispatched to go and meet with this family, and then later that afternoon to do a short memorial service. And the story itself was, it's something that I've never encountered anywhere else, which is that I met with the entire kind of family, and there was, nobody had one good thing, one redeeming thing to say about the person who had died. His son told me, I'm here because I want to be better than my father was. Both ex-wives were there, and they told me, we want to be here just for closure. That there was actually nobody had one good word to say, and I was struck that they, I was kind of going through, and I was searching for something to say. And it turned out like that there was like a decoy of a duck there, and so I was like, oh, so he liked nature. And they shook their heads and said, no, he liked to kind of kill as many things as he could. And it was this moment of, and the family actually said that he had no sense of reference. And that struck me, because I see reverence as this potential, potential force that could actually bring us closer together. That I actually ask you, what do you hold with reverence? That's that question. What do you hold with reverence? Because I assume that everybody holds something of reverence, and maybe that assumption is false, but I want to believe it, and I want to actually cultivate it. I want to cultivate in whether it's the children in our youth program, everyone should have the ability to hold things with reverence. And it's actually when we hold things with reverence that we become our most fully human, our most loving, our best selves, our best relationship partners. And we have that ability to behold beauty and to hold things in reverence. awe has a moral dimension. And so when we say as Unitarian Universalists that it is that direct experience of transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, it's that which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces that create and uphold life. There is a truth there. There is a truth there. So connect with your own powerful sense of reverence. There to ask others what it is that they hold with deep and abiding reverence. Go forth in peace. Amen. The closing hymn this morning is a hymn which doesn't do justice to reverence, but it's about it. It's the hymn, "O Come, You Longing, Thirsty Souls," and it's a hymn inspired by a chapter from the Hebrew Bible, from the text Isaiah. And there's this wonderful verse in it, which I think is in the third, where it says, "The hills shall sing, and the trees shall clap in time." Talk about awe. And so I invite you to rise in body or in spirit this morning and join in singing out this old churchy tune, "O Come, You Longing, Thirsty Souls."